kingdom of God. You can always count on God. How many of you found that to be true? I can always count on God. Yeah. Amen. Well, this morning, we're continuing in our series on being part of the team of God. And we're looking at the law of the catalyst. How many of you know what a catalyst is? You ever used J.B. Weld? I really like J.B. Weld. It's liquid steel. When I break things, I don't have to weld it. It would be better if I did, but amen. But you've got the J.B. Weld product, and you've got the catalyst. You can slap that J.B. Weld all over the piece that you're trying to fix, and it just stays wet and gooey and doesn't do anything. You can take the catalyst, and you can put it all over something you want to fix, but it just stays wet and gooey. But you put those two together, and that catalyst causes that J.B. Weld product to change what it is. There is a chemical change that takes place, and a catalyst is an agent of change. And how many of you know Jesus Christ was, is, and will be an agent of change as he enters into a life and causes that life to be completely transformed from a gooey, ooey mess? How many of you have been a gooey, gooey mess? You ever heard somebody say, well, they're just a hot mess?
Yeah.
That's what sin will leave you. Sin will just leave you a hot mess, worthless. But you add the catalyst of Jesus Christ and the blood that he shed, and everything changes, and your life becomes something of great value. And that's what the Lord wants for you through Jesus Christ. But how many of you know Jesus said, these things and greater you shall do? And if Jesus was a catalyst for our life, then he wants us to be a catalyst for this world. He wants us to be an agent of change. I'm going to make a change right now. I'm going to turn off the light. I forgot about that. He wants us to be an agent of change. And we need to look at the fact, as we're looking at teamwork and working together as the kingdom of God, that winning teams have players that make things happen. Do you believe that this morning? Winning teams have to have players that make things happen. I've found an interesting story here. How many of you are old enough to remember Ty Cobb? He was before my time. But any of you remember Ty Cobb?
Nope.
Well, Ty Cobb, Ty Cobb was 70. And at that point in time, he was involved in an interview where the reporter asked him a question. At 70 years of age, one of the greatest hitters in the sport of baseball was asked, what do you think you'd hit if you were playing in this era? Ty Cobb was a legend who had a career batting average of .367. That's outstanding. He told the reporter, only about .290, maybe .300. The sportscaster asked, is that because of the travel, the night games, the artificial turf, and all the new pitches like the slider? Cobb quickly responded to the misunderstanding, and he said, no, it's because I'm 70. We need to have that attitude. We need to be involved. We need to know that we can do it. We need to step up to the plate. Catalysts are get it done and then some, people. It's not enough for a catalyst to say, okay, I did my job, now let's watch and see. But that catalyst, once involved, you stop and think about it. If Jesus Christ had come into your life, and hopefully I'm speaking to a room full of saved people. If I'm not, you need to be saved before you leave this place, because Jesus Christ will change your life. But when Jesus Christ came into your life, and he saved you, think of all he did when he came into your life. He took you, the old song says, he took me out of the miry clay. He took you out of that sinful process that you were going through. He washed you completely. He put a healing ointment on your wounds that you got in life. He took care of you. He put you in his arms. He began touching your mind and changing it so that your thought process would be that where you would understand things in a better way and know how to deal with things. But stop and think, if Jesus Christ got you to that point and then said, I've done my job, take it from here, where would your life be? I tell you what, with him in my life, I've made enough bad mistakes. I can't imagine the goofball things I would do if Jesus wasn't with me every moment of every day. I didn't hear an amen. Wonderful. So, they're get-her-done people and then some. Catalyst, love stirring up the team. But listen to this. They love stirring up the team in a good way.
Amen.
Not in a bad way. And we've got to grab that in the kingdom of God. Some people just have the gift of stirring things up in a bad way. It's been a while since I mentioned it, but I remember one of our first galley dinners. A fella came and he said, I'd like to see your church. And I said, okay. So I'm walking around with him. He started asking me questions, and pretty soon he was asking all these questions to narrow it back into this point of theology and what the Bible says and what different theologians have said. And as he was talking to me, he said, well, don't you read the commentaries? And I said, yes, sir, I read the commentaries, but I read the Bible first. And I let the Holy Spirit speak into my heart. And then I look at the commentaries to see what he's spoken to them and see if it confirms what the Holy Spirit has been speaking to me. And if I go to them first and the Bible second, I'm a mess. And he started just going off me. And I said, wait, I'm not going to argue with you. I said, let me ask you a question. When's the last time you led a person to Jesus Christ? Whoa. I said, have you ever led anyone to Jesus Christ? He said, a few. And I said, you're willing to, you just want to sit here and argue with me instead of winning people to Jesus Christ? What is that all about? And he said, oh, well, you wouldn't believe how many pastors I've had this argument with. And I said, what good did that do? He has the gift of argument. The gift of stirring up in a bad way. And I tell you what, I was kind of rude, but I looked at him and said, I've got important things to do, and not talking to you is not one of them. And I walked away.
Amen.
I had my fill. And I believe we get caught up in those that stir things up in a negative way, and we've got to stir things up in a positive way.
Yeah.
A catalyst is one that stirs the team and lifts. And this morning, I believe God wants us to lift. That's something that he's just been pounding on me. When we talk to people, we don't need to walk into church on a Sunday morning and hear every problem that's going on this week. I know there are problems. I know you need prayer for them, and that's wonderful. Let me know. But the important thing is coming in and saying, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice.
Amen.
Regardless of what's going on in my life. And I will be glad. Tell your face is glad. It's a wonderful place to be. I will be glad in it. They stir up in a good way and to make things happen. Catalysts do whatever it takes to push the team to the next level. And far too often, we get the cart rolling and then we jump on to see how far we can ride it. But the catalyst keeps pushing. When a catalyst works continually, team members become expectant and confident. That person that is on it, that is excited, that's seeing things happen and wants to see more things happen, and they're pushing other people around them on the team, get excited with them. Why do you think they have cheerleaders at ball games? I often wondered that. Then I became a teenager. And I still wondered. I gotta tell this, Rachel would be so upset.
G-Man.
Yeah. She in junior high she became a cheerleader. And I thought, oh, I don't know how I feel about this as daddy. You know? And they got her, she got her little outfit and everything, and she went to her first practice. She came home after practice, And I said, how was cheerleading practice? She said, oh, it was so good. It was so fun, Daddy. I really liked it. And I said, what'd you do? And, they had a Georgetown G-Men. And she said, they taught us to spell G-Men. And I bit the inside of my mouth so I wouldn't laugh. And then I had to ask, how long did it take them to teach you to spell G-Men? And she said, about an hour. The tape's not rolling. Take that off that tape. But really, cheerleaders are important on the team. How many of you remember the wave? And the excitement and the energy that would bring in to a stadium when they would begin doing the wave. Some people were just, oh, this is cool. But there was an energy and an excitement and that cheerleading, that encouragement, that lifts others. And when you are down, let me tell you something. How many of you know, every once in a while as pastor, I have a blue day.
Sure, amen.
There are times that I just feel a little bit beat. I'll be real honest with you. Sometimes I get a little people weary. That's kind of tough as pastor, you know?
Yeah.
But then someone comes along. Not too long ago, I was telling the Lord, Father, ministry would be so much easier if it wasn't for people. And my phone rang. And for those of you that know Brother Bruno Gladkowski, he called and said, you know, you've been on my mind, on my heart, my mind. I've been praying for you for a couple of weeks. What's going on? And I talked to him, and he said, be praying in the Spirit. I'm praying for you.
Yeah.
God's going to bless you. And he just started pouring this cheerleading into me. And by the time I got off the phone with him, I was ready to take you all on. No, I wasn't. I'm teasing. But I needed that. And how many of you would say, there have been times in my life where I needed someone to pick me up. I didn't have the ump, and I needed someone to be a catalyst for me, to be an agent of change, and to bring that into my life. When crunch time comes, a catalyst becomes critical. And we need to understand that fact. When things get difficult, if you are called to be a catalyst, that's your shining moment. Whether a ball player that spurs his team on to win or a parent that encourages a child to overcome a fear, the catalyst can be used of God to make the difference. And this morning, we're going to get into the Old Testament. We're going to find some of my favorite stories are in the book of Samuel. I just love the book of Samuel. And we're going to turn in Samuel to Samuel chapter 17. We're going to take a look at an incredible catalyst in the kingdom of God. Not a little boy at this point. He had been a little boy with a sling and a staff, and he protected the sheep from bears and lions. And he grew up into a young teenager, and he became a catalyst for a king, for an army, and for an entire nation. If you look with me in 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 8. Talking here about Goliath, it says, he stood and shouted to the ranks of Israel and said to them, why have you come out to draw up in battle array? Am I not the Philistine and you servants of Saul? Choose a man for yourselves and let him come down to me. If he is able to fight with me and kill me, then we will become your servants. But if I prevail against him and kill him, then you will become our servants and serve us. Again, the Philistine said, I defy the ranks of Israel this day. Give me a man that we may fight together. Verse 11 says, when Saul and all of Israel heard these words of the Philistine, they were dismayed and greatly afraid. Father, this morning, we are living in a world that is dismayed, and they are incredibly fearful. Lord, as we look at our nation and those things that we are involving ourselves in at home and abroad, Father, I pray today that you will help us to recognize that these are the signs of the times, that the trumpet is getting ready to sound. Amen. and all that's taking place, mankind is responding out of fear. And we have an enemy that is standing up. Lord, he's taken the form of armies, but he's also taken the form of individuals right here around us. Lord, we have a battle to win, and you have called us to be the catalyst, the agents of change, not only in this church, but in this community, in this nation, and in this world. Help us to fulfill your call upon our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. And as we look at this story, Goliath has stepped out. The Philistines are lined up for battle. The Israelites are lined up for battle. And in the middle of this valley, this huge man steps out and says, no use in all of us fighting. Send one person, your best fighter, your best warrior, bring him out, I will take him on. And if our gods are more mighty, then we'll. But if your gods are more mighty, then you'll. Why were they so afraid? Was it because he was so big? Was it because he challenged them and challenged the Lord God? As I looked at this story, I began asking myself, why were they so afraid of one man? Weren't they the people of Jehovah? What was the big deal with this guy? And then I began asking myself a question. Should the people of God be afraid of anything? Is there anything that we as the people of God should be afraid of? And my question this morning is, do we really believe? If we are children of God and we really believe that, should we be afraid of anything in this world? 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 1 began by saying, now the Philistines gathered their army for battle, and they were gathered at Socoh, which belongs to Judah. Did you realize that? That the Philistines had placed themselves on Judah's property. They had come in and taken control of property that belonged to the children of God. And they camped between Socoh and Ezkah in Ephesidom. I think I got that close. Saul and the men of Israel were gathered and camped in the valley of Elah and drew up in battle array to encounter the Philistines. The Philistines stood on the mountain on one side, and while Israel stood on the mountain on the other side, and the valley between them. Then the champion came out from the armies of the Philistines, named Goliath, from Gath, whose height was 6 cubits in span. He had a bronze helmet on his head, and he was clothed with scale armor, which weighed 5,000 shekels of bronze. He also had bronze greaves on his legs, and a bronze javelin slung between his shoulders. The shaft of his spear was like a weaver's beam, and the head of his spear weighed 600 shekels of iron. His shield carrier also walked before him. How many of you know how much a shekel is? Well, let's take a look at that. First, it says he was over 9 feet tall. And I believe when we were studying this with the teenagers, it's about as high as that level with the lights are. He stood about that tall. The coat of mail weighed 156 pounds. How many of you would like to wear 156 pounds in the battle? His huge spear had an iron head that weighed over 18 pounds. Just the head of the spear weighed 18 pounds. How long did that spear have to be, and how heavy was it just to balance to throw? The total weight of his armor was over 272 pounds. Now, a normal soldier carried about 60 pounds. This is 4.5 times what a normal soldier could carry. Now, considering this, how big he was, what his arsenal was that he was packing, do we really believe the way David did? 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 21 says, Israel and the Philistines drew up in battle array, army against army. Then David left his baggage in the care of the baggage keeper and ran to the battle line and entered in order to greet his brothers. As he was talking with them, behold, the champion, the Philistine from Gath named Goliath, was coming up from the army of the Philistines. And he spoke these words, and David heard them. When all the men of Israel saw the man, they fled from him and were greatly afraid. The men of Israel said, have you seen this man who is coming up? Surely he is coming up to defy Israel. And it will be that the king will enrich the man who kills him with great riches and will give him his daughter and make his father's house free in Israel. Then David spoke to the men who were standing by him, saying, what will be done for the man who kills the Philistine and takes away the reproach from Israel? For who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should taunt the armies of the living God? All these valiant soldiers are quaking in their boots, and young David, a teenage boy, he comes up saying, who is this guy? What's his problem? He's taunting the army of God? This is the voice of someone who really believes. As David spoke these words, he knew in his heart that God was greater than any giant. Do we really believe that? 1 Samuel 17, verse 31. When the words which David spoke were heard, they were told to Saul, and he went for him, or sent for him, excuse me. David said to Saul, let no man's heart fail on account of him. Your servant will go and fight with the Philistine. Then Saul said to David, you're not able to go against this Philistine to fight with him, for you're but a youth, while he has been a warrior from his youth. But David said to Saul, your servant was tending his father's sheep when a lion or a bear came and took a lamb from the flock. I went out after him and attacked him and rescued it from his mouth. And when he rose up against me, I seized him by his beard and struck him and killed him. Your servant has killed both the lion and the bear, and this uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them, since he has taunted the armies of the living God. And David said, the Lord who delivered me from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear, he will deliver me from the hand of this Philistine. And Saul said to David, go and may the Lord be with you. Whew. Teenage boy standing before the king. King says, you can't go. He says, listen to me, king. That lion came and took a lamb that belonged to me. I was responsible. I went and took that lamb back, rescued him, and then I took that critter out. Lion and bear, I took them both on individually. And this Philistine, if he saw a lion or a bear coming at him, he'd turn around and run. I'm not afraid. I'm going to go in because the same God that gave me the victory with that lion and that bear, this Philistine has nothing on them. I think King Saul heard David's heart and believed. The catalyst, David the catalyst, spoke to the king and spoke words that lifted him up, and the king began to believe. And today, the question is, do we really believe? Verse 40 says, he took his stick in his hand. There you go. What are you going to fight with? Well, I got a stick here. He took this stick in his hand and chose for himself 5 smooth stones from the brook and put them in the shepherd's bag, which he had even in his pouch. And his sling was in his hand, and he approached the Philistine. Now, I think this is pretty interesting. We read all the armament that this Philistine had. And David picks up a stick and he picks up 5 smooth stones and grabs his sling. Shadow of doubt. As I study that, I've come to the conclusion that God will use what we have and what we're familiar with. If we read in there, the king tried to suit him up with his armor, but it was clunky, it was cumbersome, it was a problem. David said, I can't go to battle with this. And he put it off to the side. He went and got his five smooth stones. Because David, when you're a shepherd and you're alone with a bunch of sheep, what do you have to do except find rocks and hurl them at trees? David was comfortable with the equipment that God had given him. He took the stick in his hand for himself and chose for himself five smooth stones from the brook, and he put them in his shepherd's bag, which he had even in his pouch. And his sling was in his hand, and he approached the Philistine. He didn't wait for the problem to come to him. He approached the Philistine. Now look at this. Then the Philistine came on and approached David with his shield bearer in front of him. Did you realize that? He wasn't going to come first. There's a guy coming. You go first. When the Philistine looked and saw little David, he disdained him. For he was but a youth and ruddy, with a handsome appearance. Oh, he's young. He's vital. He's a good-looking kid. Goliath, I believe it was probably a pretty ugly dude. The Philistine said to David, am I a dog that you come to me with sticks? And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. The Philistine also said to David, come to me, and I will give your flesh to the birds of the sky and to the beasts of the field. This is important. The Philistine, Goliath, this uncircumcised goofball, looks at David, the young man of God, and he says, come to me, I will give your flesh to the birds of the sky and the beasts of the field. Then David said to the Philistines, you come to me with a sword and a spear and a javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have taunted. This day the Lord will deliver you into my hand, and I will strike you down and remove your head from you. And I will give the dead bodies of the armies of the Philistines this day to the birds of the sky and the wild beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel.
Amen.
I tell you what, you talk about a catalyst. Not only was Goliath hearing this, but the armies of Israel are hearing this. Not only are the armies of Israel hearing this and getting excited, but the armies of the Philistines are hearing this and beginning to wonder. As we look back, verse 47, and that all the assembly may know that the Lord does not deliver by sword or by spear, for the battle is the Lord, and he will give you into our hands. Then it happened. When the Philistine rose and came and drew near to meet David, that David quickly ran toward the battle line to meet the Philistine. He didn't. I tell you what, that guy all of a sudden comes charging at me. I might dig my foot in. I might be looking around to see where I need to run. But David charged into battle. He didn't even have his stuff ready. Listen to this. And David put his hand into his bag while he's running. Took from the bag the stone, and he slung it, and he struck the Philistine on the forehead, and the stone sank into his forehead so that he fell on his face to the ground. I want you to stop and think about it. All the armament that Goliath was wearing, and he looks and sees a little kid, if he's not scared of him, is he going to keep that armament on, or is he going to put it down and say, come on? Kept all the armament on. He had his chest protected. He had the top of his head. He had his legs protected. He had things on his shoulders and arms. He had his shield. He was ready to go. But his forehead was exposed. The one place And God caused that stone to fly and sink deep into his head. And Tish, if you'll come to the piano. David was victorious that day. Not David, but God. My question as I got into this story, what was the difference between David and all the other individuals in the army of Israel? Those that David called the army of God. It was made up of individuals. What was different about David, this young boy who went out with a sling and a stone expecting God to deliver, than these mighty men who were valiant warriors who had all the equipment? What was the difference between the two of them? Listen to me this morning. David believed. And if you believe, all things are possible. All things are possible. The question I've been asking all morning is, do we believe? David believed. 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 51. Then David ran and stood over the Philistine and took his sword and drew it out of its sheath and killed him and cut off his head with it. When the Philistines saw that their champion was dead, they fled. The men of Israel and Judah arose and shouted and pursued the Philistines as far as the valley and to the gates of Ekron. And the slain Philistines lay along the way to Shechem, even to Gath and Ekron. You talk about an incredible victory. These Philistines were so confident in themselves that they came and set up in the enemy's territory. They came and set up on the property that God had given his people. And they said, we are here, we're going to do battle, we're going to win, there's nothing you can do about it. And here's our champion to start things out. And all of a sudden, the catalyst, David, anointed of God, stood up and said, this is not going to happen. But God is going to turn it all around. And when David cut off the head of that giant, and I thought it was interesting, David struck him with a stone, he dropped to the ground. I would have hoped that the army of God would have jumped to their feet and been in the battle, but they waited. The Bible says they waited long enough for David to go over and take the sword of Goliath, this big old heavy sword. He pulls it out of its sheath. He grabs Goliath's hair and pulls his head up and he takes his head off. Then the armies of Israel are rallied. They stand to their feet and they pursue the enemy in victory. So was it really all about David? No. It was all about the power of God. David was the catalyst. And this morning, it's not all about you. It's about the kingdom of God, but he wants to use you as a catalyst. The question this morning comes down to, do you believe? I'm studying a book right now that is just rocking my world. Talking about how mind works and how habits can be changed and what we can do to change the lives of people through the way they respond. And as I'm reading this book, I came across a story, an incredible man of God in the NFL named Tony Dungy. He was coaching a team, the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, and they were so pitiful. Amen. They were bad. They fell apart. Just, they couldn't play. Tony Dungy went in and he said, fellas, I've got a new way of doing football. And if you will listen to me and if you will will take hold of this, I will make you into a championship team. Tony began the practices. They went to games and they lost. They went back to practicing. They went to games and they lost. They practiced it some more. They went to games. They were losing, and there was a point in time where all of a sudden something clicked. And Tony said, we're losing, but I'm winning because it's starting to kick in. It wasn't too far after that that they began to win games. They won enough games that they got to go to some of the championships. But when they got in the championships, they just completely fell apart. As Tony began examining what was taking place, what he had taught them was working. And they were excited in it as long as they were winning. But as soon as things got tough, as soon as the going got rough, when it got difficult, they reverted back to the way they played when they were a sorry team. After a few years of going to playoffs and losing miserably, he got fired. And another pretty miserable team called the Indianapolis Colts hired him as their coach. The coach said, look, I'll worry about playoffs later. I just want to win a game. And he went in and he grabbed the guys and did the same thing with them. And they had some good field commanders. They had a young man at the time named Peyton Manning. And on defense they had Mr. Freeman.
Freeney.
And they bought in and they believed. Before long, that pitiful team began winning football games. They even got into some football games where they were behind, but they came back and won. But then they'd get into the playoffs, and everything would fall apart. One year at the end of their season, Tony Dungy and his wife were asleep, and the phone rang. His wife answered and figured it was for him. That time of the night, she handed it straight to Tony. He picked it up, and it was the hospital saying, your son tried to commit suicide. Crushed his larynx. We've kept him alive for a while, but he's passed away. With grief, trying to work through things, as a born-again Christian, his wife told him to go back to work. His player said, please come back to work. He went back to work. And as he's there working, trying to get through things, his players start realizing, we've got to do something. Individually, without coming together, each one of them started deciding in their own hearts and minds, I'm going to give them everything I got. Season's about over. We're not going anywhere this year, but I'll still give them everything I got. And they won out the rest of the season. And they started believing. The next year, they played, and they played incredibly. And they got to the place that they were at the playoffs against the Patriots, their nemesis. Everything got heavy, and they reverted back to their old way of playing. At halftime, they were so far behind, no team had ever come back and won after a deficit like that in the playoffs. They went into the locker room. It's halftime, dead silent. They could hear the crowds outside. Tony Dungy got up in front of them, and he basically said, fellas, you must believe. If you believe, this game is ours. We can win this. It belongs to us. But you must believe. And something he was saying to them clicked, and they realized we've got to stay with what we know is true. We've got to stay in that strength. We've got to do what we were supposed to do. And they got out on the field, and people had turned off their televisions. They had called it a wash, and they fought their way back, and they ended up winning and going on to the Super Bowl. As I was reading that book, I began wondering, God, how many times have we listened to you and followed your instruction until the pressure hit? How many times have we been excited and singing, the joy of the Lord is my strength? But then as soon as things get really tough, we revert back to the way we used to be. We revert back to the way we used to think. We revert back to the way we used to do things, and then we fail miserably, and we ask God, why did you let me down? Be not conformed, but be transformed, changed by the renewing of your mind. Old things have passed away, and all things must become new. But they become new again and again and again. We've got to continually keep that thought process. And when the enemy comes against us, it's not time for us to say, oh no, here we go again. We're going to lose again. It's going to be a battle. Oh no. But to say, the battle belongs to the Lord. And God needs you, listen to me this morning, and I don't mean to be harsh, but he needs us to step out of our pity parties. And stand up. And say, Father, I'm going to be a catalyst. I am going to be an agent of change in the world around me. This morning, my question to you one more time is, do we believe? Or more personally, do you believe? Not only that God can save you from hell, but that God can deliver you in the situations in this life, in the trials, in the bad situations. Do you believe he can be the one who takes care of your finances? Do you believe that he will take care of your children? Do you believe that he will take care of your job? Do you believe that he will take care of your health? Do you believe that he will give you peace? Do you believe he will give you rest? God wants you to be the agent of change, but that will only take place if you believe. I'd like to ask you to stand with me this morning. Father, right now in Jesus' name, I speak a blessing into each one under the sound of my voice. I speak the blessing of faith. Because without faith, it is impossible to please you, Father. And I want each one in this room to please you. I speak the blessing of faith. I speak the blessing of believing, of knowing that they know that they know that they know that you are God, that you are in control, that no weapon formed against us can prosper, but with God all things are possible. Father, I speak the blessing of newness of strength within. Lord, that willpower. Lord, so often we talk about our will and your will, and they're in conflict. But Father, as you put your will into our life, we need willpower to stay with what you've given us. Lord, they've demonstrated that willpower is a muscle that must be flexed and exercised and used. Lord, I pray today in Jesus' name we will begin allowing you to exercise our willpower. And I speak the blessing of strength in that willpower. I speak the blessing of newness of mind. I speak the blessing of newness of desire. Lord, I speak the blessing of joy from being victorious. Father, I speak the blessing of believing. Lord, right now in Jesus' name, as we boil all this down, I speak the blessing that each one recognizes that they are a catalyst for the gospel of Jesus Christ. And that there are people all around them that have words of the gospel that just kind of float around with no real purpose in their life, and that you desire to make them an agent of change. Lord, that each one of us is that catalyst when added to the word that has been brought into each life, that it changes it into an incredible life with joy unspeakable and full of your glory. Father, I speak that into each life as a blessing today. Now, Lord, may each one receive that blessing. Walk in that blessing. Live in that blessing as the catalyst of God. Lord, I count it as done in Jesus' name. And everyone that received that blessing said, amen. Amen. Lord bless you. Be an agent of change. Let God